In this video, we're using Ampere's law to compute the magnetic field generated by a current running through a long, thick, cylindrical shell conductor. So to clarify what we're looking at in the diagrams, the thick, conductive cylindrical shell has an inner radius of A and an outer radius of B. And inside the radius A, that's hollow, so there's no conductive material in there. And that's particularly obvious in the face-on view on the right, where the current is coming straight out of the page, and we can clearly see that hollow cross-section inside the radius of A. And we naturally have three regions where we want to compute the magnetic field, and that's inside the inner radius A, outside the outer radius B, and then the interesting part is the magnetic field within the conductive material itself. Now we're told that the current density J, that's current per unit cross-sectional area, is uniform in this case. So it has the same value through the entire conductive cross-section. And we're also told to express all magnetic field magnitudes in terms of the total current, I. So at the bottom here, we have a reminder of Ampere's law, which is useful to us in cases with a high degree of symmetry. And that says that the path integral of magnetic field along an Amperian loop is equal to mu naught times the current enclosed by that loop. And I'll post a link to the video where Ampere's law was first derived. Below that, we have a reminder of the definition of current density. And again, that's current per unit cross-sectional area, which we could also write as I over A, where I is the current distributed over a cross-section of A. Finally, we can see an Amperian loop in the diagrams already, and that has a radius that we call little r. Now, this loop has been chosen to share the symmetry of the problem, where we expect the magnetic field to swirl around the symmetry axis concentrically by way of a right-hand rule, so we choose Amperian loops centered on the symmetry axis as well. And the loop we're showing here has a radius in between A and B. In other words, it's for the most interesting case in the problem where we want to compute the magnetic field in the conductive material itself. Now, before we calculate that interesting magnetic field, let's see why the other two cases are trivial. First, if we take an Amperian loop inside the radius A, then the enclosed current is zero in there because that's the hollow center of the thick shell. So we can write down Ampere's law, and then that enclosed current on the right-hand side of Ampere's law is going to vanish. And you may just want to jump straight to saying, well, then the magnetic field must be zero. But just as a reminder of what goes on inside this path integral, that's always a trivial path integral. We've chosen an Amperian loop that lines up exactly with any potential circulating magnetic field. And so the dot product is going to be trivial there. B dotted into DL turns into just B times DL because the magnetic field points in the same direction as every path increment. And then because our Amperian loop is lined up with the symmetry of the conductor, the magnitude of B is also constant, so we can factor it out of the integral. So these are all the usual Ampere's law tricks. But just to show one of the in-between steps here, we've now used the fact that the dot product was trivial, so we just get the product of the magnitudes of those two vectors, and we've used the fact that B is constant in magnitude, so we could factor it out of the integral. And we're just left with the path integral of DL, which is just the circumference of the Amperian loop. So that left-hand side becomes just B times 2 pi R. And again, the right-hand side of Ampere's law is zero because the enclosed current is zero when we're inside this cavity. Now just dividing both sides by 2 pi R, then we discover that B has a magnitude of zero when R is less than A. The second trivial case is if we take an Amperian loop outside the radius B. Then the total enclosed current is just the total current I. So again, we write down Ampere's law. And I just replaced I enclosed with the entire current I in that case. And all the same tricks happen with the path integral on the left. This is what we're always doing when we apply Ampere's law. So I have an Amperian loop where the magnitude of B is constant. It's also a swirling concentric magnetic field. So the magnetic field vector is always in the same direction as the path increment DL. So our dot product is trivial, B is constant, we factor it out of the integral, and we end up with the path integral of DL, which again is just 2 pi r. So that left-hand side again is just B times 2 pi r, and the right-hand side is mu naught I, where I is the total current flowing in this conductor. So this gives us now a result that we've seen several times before. I end up with mu naught I divided by 2 pi r. And this is the same result that we previously found for a thin wire and for a thick wire, provided we were outside the radius of the wire. In other words, the structure of the wire itself doesn't really matter. The field outside a long wire is always going to be that same old mu naught I divided by 2 pi r, because the entire current is enclosed in an Amperian loop out there. So now we can finally look at the really interesting case for this problem, and that's when R is between A and B. So I've written up here, A is less than R, which in turn is less than B, which is just the mathematical way of saying R is between A and B. And again, we can write down Ampere's law. And the path integral on the left-hand side is going to be trivial in exactly the same way it has been in the last two cases. That's going to turn out again to be B times 2 pi R for all the same reasons. But the right-hand side is where things get complicated. Because when we think about I enclosed here, well, our Amperian loop is now only capturing part of the total current I, and we need to compute how much. So here we've just shaded the part inside the loop that's actually capturing current. So that only includes the part of the conductor that's inside the loop, not the part that's actually a hole in the middle. So to find the enclosed current, we have to turn around our definition of current density. Remember, that's current divided by cross-sectional area. And instead we write it as the amount of current contained in a given cross-sectional area is J times A. So we continue to work on Ampere's law here. And we have on the left-hand side our classic B times 2 pi R. And on the right-hand side we have mu naught times I enclosed, which is the current density J, times the total cross-sectional area of the conductor contained inside that Amperian loop. Well, that's the area of an annulus now with an outer radius of r and an inner radius of a. So we just take the area of the outer circle, pi little r squared, and subtract the area of the inner circle, which is pi times a squared. So at this point, I'll go ahead and solve for b. And we can go ahead and factor pi out of the right-hand side and cancel that with the pi on the left-hand side as we're cleaning this thing up. So we end up with this expression. The magnetic field is mu naught times j times r squared minus a squared, all divided by 2 little r. And we're still not done, because we were asked to express the magnetic field in terms of the total current flowing through the conductor, not the current density. So we have to go back to our definition of current density, and then we're going to find a relationship between our current density and the total current in the wire. So what we do is we consider the entire wire, and our current density is going to be the total current flowing in the entire wire divided by the total conducting cross-section of the entire wire, which is now an annulus with outer radius b and inner radius a. So we're going to have the area of the outer circle, pi b squared, minus the area of the inner circle, pi a squared. So this allows us to finally get to our desired expression for the magnetic field in this in-between region. We're going to replace j with this whole expression, and that gives us a mu naught I times r squared minus a squared. And then in the denominator, I'm going to go ahead and factor the pi out and put that together with the 2r that was already there. So we end up with a 2 pi r. And then we have this leftover piece of b squared minus a squared. So remember, the magnetic field inside the cavity of this conductor was zero. The magnetic field outside the outer radius was our classic mu naught I over 2 pi r. And then the really interesting result was in this in-between region, where it turns out to be mu naught I times the quantity r squared minus a squared over 2 pi r times quantity b squared minus a squared. In the next video, we're going to solve another thick conductive shell magnetic field problem. But this time, the current density is going to be non-uniform, dropping off like 1 over r. I'll post a link to that video at the upper left when it's done, and I'll see you there.